Hi, good morning, everyone. It's 8 a.m. and we're going to go ahead and get started. It's my pleasure to introduce Richard Tonry and Mohit Arora from Dell. And dude, you are getting a Dell.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mohit Arora. I'm a software security architect at Dell within the Client Solutions organization.
And my name is Richard Tonry. I am a firmware security architect in our Dell Client Security Dell Client Solutions Group.
Yep.
We're here to do our talk. Dude, you're getting a Dell.
Say that again. Dude, you're getting a Dell.
Organizational culture shift to SDL maturity.
That's right.
And before we get started, just want to talk a little bit about security is a serious topic. But we want to try to make that a little bit entertaining for you guys. So if you happen to find it funny, you happen to laugh a little bit, maybe you'll crack a rib or break a hip, or maybe you'll laugh yourself to death. Hey, just want to thank you for, taking one for the team.
That's right.
And we're kind of stalling a little bit here because this is our first time. It's our first time actually doing a public conference. Yep. And just kind of wondering, where are the goons? Are we supposed to do shots?
I think this is not the, this is a different conference.
It's a different conference.
Yeah,
okay.
Got the wrong one.
All right. So, I guess we can do a little celebratory toast then.
Sure. That sounds good.
Yeah. Speaking of water or celebratory post, we, RSA has speaker coaches, and the speaker coaches told us that if you kind of lose your place and you get a little nervous or something, you can come over here and take a long drink of water to help you get back to where you were.
I'm taking a...
Yeah, especially if you're nervous,
Take a 50-second sip right here.
Yeah, my sip's going to take 50 minutes.
Just joking. With that, another tip that our coach told us was, tell an interesting story, right? Have some facts, have some rhetorical questions, right?
Yeah, so let's go ahead and get started.
So with that, let's just start with the rhetorical questions. Are there any rhetorical questions?
Hey, Mohit.
Oh, Richard, okay, yeah.
I got one.
Sure.
So how do you go about changing the security culture of an organization?
That's a good question. Let me ask you, how do you go about changing the security culture of a large organization like Dell?
Okay. In addition to how, why would you mm-hmm. want to change the security culture of an organization?
You know what? That's a great question. I'm actually glad you asked. Let's talk about it.
All right. Let's talk about it. So let's talk about why.
Why are we here? The security culture of your organization really is going to impact your customers and your brand, right?
Yes. And it also helps you with the ability to scale, and it helps you with your bottom line. So talk about cost. So vulnerabilities are expensive. It's a pay now or pay later philosophy. Usually it costs more to pay later, and paying later could have some brand damage and potentially some customer impact.
Right. And then from a scale, especially around vulnerabilities, it's not about are you mature now, it's about are you mature for what's to come tomorrow. So at Dell, scale is a key factor in our decision to continue maturing our security culture. And then, as we mentioned, the impact to your customers and brand is also very important. We did a quick Google search on just, hey, what are the top data breaches? And this is the first link with the first table that actually came up.
Right. And so even if you dealt with your security vulnerability or security breach properly and regained customer trust, no matter how good your security is now, if somebody does a search for your product and finds something like this, it may continue to impact your brand. Here's another example. Do you recognize this ship?
If you don't, this is the Titanic.
Did that trigger a response or a reaction? Right. Here's a product that had a significant impact on its customers and its brand image.
Right. So no one's ever going to name a ship Titanic again, right?
Yeah, right. No one's going to ever name a product Titanic again.
Exactly.
And no one will never name their kids Titanic again.
Yeah, that's probably not going to happen.
Oops.
Yep, sorry about that. And so...
And here's another obvious example.
Yep. Probably why most of you are here today.
Right. It's probably why our talk got selected.
A nice,
that awesome title.
Very, very cool title there. And then let's talk about our objectives, right? So we're here today to kind of walk you through how we at Dell, at a large company, approach this challenge. And again, specifically around from the viewpoint of the Client Solutions Group, which Richard and I are part of.
Right. And so let's go over our objectives. you know, we ask questions how, and we ask some questions why in our rhetorical questions. So, so why? The insights into the organizational impetus for change. What we experienced and why we went down our path. And then the how. It's understanding how to shift a security culture in a large organization. So we'll talk about how we did it, especially in the context of a Dell's client organization, and integrating with our Pan-Dell security governance body within the Dell Technologies. We'll give you the lessons learned and top 10 key takeaways that we think are pertinent to any organization. And we're going to leave you with some steps to help your organization get started in our call to action section. To put it into context, we want to describe the scale.
Right.
Dell Technologies is a large company.
Yeah, so it's a global business, right? We have a very diverse product portfolio and customer base, and it's literally businesses inside of a business, right? And actually, another shipping analogy is pretty fitting here.
Yeah, but it's more like a ship carrying other ships, or a shipping ship shipping shipping ships.
Yeah, say that five times fast.
All right. So this is us. You know, our talk will be from the client solutions perspective, and the client solutions group is one of the ships on the Dell Technologies shipping ship. So you might say we are a shipping ship on a shipping ship, shipping, shipping ships.
Wow, you gotta love that.
I got it.
You gotta love the English language. So how did we start, right? So at Dell, our story takes us from a product-based security model to a unified security model. So although we've been doing security for a long time, we've had segmented security practices across the organization with varying levels of maturity across the organization as well.
Right, and we've had our series of events to fuel our maturity, events from the Edel root vulnerability to the Spectre meltdown vulnerabilities to the Intel and Microsoft bug bounty programs. This got us some executive top-down focus to help drive these changes. Another such event is the Dell EMC merger. So, you know, we've had our share of events, and with any organization, events can serve as catalyst. So your culture shift may start with an event. It could be a positive event, such as mergers and acquisitions, or
negative.
Oh. Or positive audits.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
Or
negative events, like we mentioned earlier, security breaches and vulnerabilities. It's really about what gets people talking within the organization, right? That's what it's about.
So you can use the event to gain an attention to build some momentum.
And momentum is powerful, so you can use that actually to gather some volunteers behind your cause, especially if you're starting out small.
And you know, when you're working with a large organization, inertia is a problem. But when you get it moving, that momentum is very powerful.
Right, but that said, an event's not really required. Whatever we're gonna go over today here today will apply regardless to your organization. So what comes next? So at Dell, we started by getting our baseline, right? In order to get our baseline, we needed a measuring stick, a framework to which we could measure ourselves by. So we actually had a third-party auditor come in and review our security practices, and we actually ended up using their framework to begin with, right? We got the assessment, and with the results of the assessment and their framework, we actually stepped back and calibrated their framework to align with the industry, align with how we do business at Dell and develop products at Dell. And so we ended up actually defining our own framework to measure our maturity by.
Yeah, and in your organization, this is really your first steps and your first stage in your culture shift. So we're at the beginning of the process here. You can use some momentum to either hire the expertise, or you can bring in a third party to help you with your baseline. Your management may be a little hesitant about having their org looked at under a microscope. You know, nobody really wants to be called out on issues. But external entities, such as auditors, are really most qualified to assess your organization. They also have a snapshot of other companies and can inform you on where your organization sits relative to other organizations in the industry.
Right. And then we also wanted to give you one example, the BSIM framework as a maturity framework. We're just throwing this up so it kind of touches upon the key areas that any framework touches upon. So it's not about having the silver bullet, there's not one that's going to work best, you know, but it's what works for your business, your industry, and your products, right? So the key point here we're trying to make is that make sure you start out with a framework, right? Something that's existing is probably the best to start with.
So where do you go after baselining? You put together a maturity plan. So, Mohit?
Richard?
How do you do that?
Well, I got a simple formula for you. You take your target, minus your gaps, and then you got your plan.
Simple, right?
Right?
Next.
Not that simple.
Yeah, sigh. So let's start with figuring out our target, and that's based on the formula. So at Dell, we found that these are some of the factors that played a major role in selecting our target. After our baselining, we approached our target in a phased, practical approach. We found that some teams are already working at or above our target level, but others needed to do some work to get there. And tip for those in the audience, your target may not be obvious at first, and you may need to do a few iterations to settle on, you know, your target.
Right. So why don't we dig into these factors a little bit here. So for alignment, you have your institutional alignment, right? So if you do have a central security office, a CISO office, that is a great place to start your culture shift. Use that as your engine to enforce and get this kicked off. The other is your executive alignment, and we're going to touch on that quite a bit a little later. But the point there is make sure your executives are aligned to the path you're going on, the goals you have, and why you're doing this to begin with.
Sure. Another factor for your target is your business needs. So you should consider your customer requirements and on how your products are developed securely. So you may have customers in government, banking, healthcare, finance, and they may have their own specific requirements that need to be met. Also, think about compliance and regulations such as privacy, GDPR, HIPAA, PCI, et cetera. And then, you know, just a tip, trying to achieve the highest level of maturity may not make, good business sense.
Yep, and then risk tolerance also plays a great factor. And, you know, risk is a very complicated topic. We could spend a whole talk on that here. We took a very simple approach. First, you know, we spoke to our leaders, right? They understand the bigger picture. They understand the business. They know what the risk tolerance is of the business. The second is inferring risk based on decisions that are being made in the business, right? For example, we all do security reports. We have findings in those. And a quick trick to figure out the risk tolerance is to see, what is your business okay shipping with today? Are they okay shipping with medium severity vulnerabilities or low severity vulnerabilities? Kind of helps you draw the line with a quick, you know, trick to figure out what the risk tolerance is in your business. That's just one example. I'm sure there's more out there.
And then there's investment. So how much can you invest in security? How much are you willing to invest? And then how much should you invest? And then what other additional investments is needed to achieve your targeted maturity level? So you may want to evaluate the investment needed for each maturity target that you have and that you're considering, and then work with the business to see what your target is based on the company's risk posture and then the business needs.
So we talked about our target.
Let's talk about the gaps.
Right.
Remember our simple formula?
I think we're going to do a patent on that, by the way.
A patent pending.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Right. The target minus the gaps is your plan.
Right. So for us at Dell, to fully understand our gaps, especially in the client business, we actually went very granular. We went team by team, product by product, to really understand where they all were from an SDL security maturity perspective, right? And that aligned with what our target was and what our goals were. We really fully understood what we needed to fill those gaps. And in our experience, these are some areas of gaps that we came across, so we figured we'd share these with you, and you might come across these as well.
Sure, so let's talk about SDL governance. So there's high-level SDL policy, and then multiple low-level SDL procedures per business unit and product line. So for example, at Dell, the development model we use for our BIOS firmware teams is different from the cloud app teams, and then therefore needs SDL activities aligned with those different development models. You know, this may not apply to small organizations that have a single development model.
Right, and then moving to VR or vulnerability response governance, that could be a gap. As we mentioned earlier, it's not that you may not have a policy. You may already be doing this without a policy, right? This is a very reactionary process. But the key is that, as we mentioned earlier, you want to make sure you're able to scale, right, to what's to come in the future. So you may be starting out small with a small team and small number of vulnerabilities, but you want to make sure you have enough resources to scale for what's to come. And what that brings you is not treating every vulnerability that's reported in your product as a fire drill. You actually treat it as part of the process and makes it very streamlined and considered.
Sure. Next is technical standards and best practices. So for technical standards, they need to be considered and addressed as part of the gap assessment. For example, aligning the company on a cryptographic algorithm standard or a secure protocol specification that's aligned with the industry.
And then there's training. That's a more obvious one, right? But what you want to make sure is that you do have sufficient training in place to meet your target goals. So if you're setting a plan together, if you believe training is going to be a gap, it's good to identify that now, have it fully funded as part of your plan. For example, at a company like Dell, you know, where not every employee's day-to-day job is around security, they may not be working on a security product per se, so they will need additional training even to get to that target maturity level, right?
Yes, and so also people. So you'll need to consider your people resources to enable rolling out your program. So starting out, you can use ad hoc resources or volunteers, but you'll want to formalize it. So you can possibly do this with a formal security champion program, and that's what we did at Dell, and we're going to talk about more about that later.
Yeah, and then the execution. The reason the execution is here as a gap is if you, like Richard was saying, if you believe you don't have enough resources committed and available to make this a success, you want to identify that now. It's better to call that out now before you get on the path and you're going down the road and then you realize, hey, we do have a gap in execution. We can't make this successful without, you know, proper allocation of resources. So make sure it is a fully funded and official program in your business.
Sure. And then for tools and infrastructure, there's process, workflow, and audit tools. And there's also SDL tools, such as data code analysis, threat model tools. Those need to be considered. Also, don't forget infrastructure. So, you might need, you know, like secure labs, badge access rooms. If you have build servers, you might need to protect those. Also, don't forget, if you're signing code, you need HSMs.
So those are more of the organizational gaps. Then we also came across something that we call the intangible gaps, more behavioral gaps, all right? We wanted to highlight these for you because, you know, we came across these the hard way, learned our lessons, so we wanted to share them with you. First one being security culture within each employee. That's a key one because in many organizations, depending on your current culture, security may be an afterthought, a rubber stamp type activity, right? So one approach that Richard, myself, and other security folks in the company took was when we sit down with our teams and go through, for example, threat models, we would actually walk them through the attack, right? Put them in the shoes of the attacker, show how something that's a vulnerability could actually be exploited. And we would actually see that light bulb moment in their heads that, oh, I get it. I understand why we need to mitigate this. And then they would go off because they know the product much more than we do and find other threats that are similar. So that really got the point across with our employees. And in addition, we did the friendly competition. So recently, teams have been coming to us and saying, hey, I've only had X number of vulnerabilities reported in my product, and so-and-so team only has this. So it's more of a badge of honor system. And it turns into a nice friendly competition. Again, it speaks to that culture that we're building within each employee.
Yep, those little tiny, you know, changes in your culture take effect. So then there's cross-organizational executive leadership commitment. And this might be more pertinent to larger organizations. You want your executives aligned across the organization. If not, you might have VPs with conflicting priorities. One way to do this is have the executive set the example. This helps to push requirements to their team members and then other executives. One example was at Dell, one of our executives took our first level security champion training, and then he required all of his individual contributors and then his first line managers to take it as well. Other executives actually followed suit, so you know, followed his example. Next is a cross-functional team alignment. So your culture shift needs to go beyond engineering. Teams such as legal, public relations, marketing, sales quality. You want everyone aligned and you want everyone speaking the same language.
Okay, so we had our target, right? We identified some of our gaps, and the next was formalizing that into a plan, right, to get those addressed. One of the key components of formalizing your plan is getting the organization-wide commitment. And as Richard spoke about, you know, key in getting executives aligned, and you know, that sometimes is easier, it's a lot less number of folks, but actually getting each team member and their managers and their directors to actually buy in and commit to the plan. And the way we approached this was we actually went team by team again, right? Showed our plan, took in their concerns, put that into our plan before we officially rolled it out. And that really drove home the point that we really need to do this and got their commitments. The second is resources, and we've been touching upon resources and funding. We're not gonna go through it a lot, but what we are gonna focus here is on the people side.
So speaking about resource and organizational-wide commitments, as part of formalizing our plan, we established the Security Champion and Security Advisor Program. In client, when we first got started, we began developing our own security training program. This included a security champion program and a security champion recognition program. After the Dell EMC merger, we regrouped and aligned with the central security organizations on the PANDEL program. This is what the PANDEL program looks like, and Mohit's going to talk a little bit about that.
Right. So as Richard said, this is how it's structured. It is a belt system with discrete levels, 1 through 5. So levels 1 through 3 are targeted for the security champions of your organization. It's open to everyone, and what we require of our champions is to spend at least 20 to 50% of their time on security activities. And as part of that, we expect them to also make sure they're aligned with their roles, right? So we don't want to have them just to be a champion to be a champion. It has to be aligned with their primary duties and their primary job function. One of the key things that we've pointed out to our champions is that they're leaders of their teams, right? They are the SMEs of their organization. They're going to help drive this culture shift. And so giving them that responsibility really gives them that leadership role in the team and in the organization. And then we have levels 4 and 5. Those are the more advisor level roles. That's when, you know, we're actually having folks training and mentoring other champions across the organizations. They are actually working on improving the program, the governance, whether it's SDL or vulnerability response. And they're actually working at that higher level on the security strategy of the organization.
Sure, so let's talk about the champion levels. Those are levels 1 to 3. This requires training courses to be completed. It's made up of mandatory and elective courses. The electives are role-based. And at the advisor level, levels 4 and 5, require job experience and demonstrated security leadership within the organization. This leads to the security advisor roles, you know, the brown and black belts there. Champions are nominated. Sometimes they're volunteered, but we would prefer that they actually are nominated. We would like them to be interested in security. Even if they have no security experience, none's required, they're going to be trained in security. Champions are embedded subject matter experts, and that helps drive the culture shift from within their teams, and then that's what we consider the bottoms-up approach from the security maturity culture shift. So, and finally, we also have the champion recognition program to reward champions through their career progression.
Yeah, almost sounds like you could make a gig out of this security thing, huh?
Yeah, no kidding. Who would have guessed?
Yeah, not me. So.
All right.
Yep.
So we have a plan, we have a direction, and we're ready to execute.
Yeah, no problem, guys, right? Straight path to security maturity, straight shot.
Straight road to security maturity.
Yeah, you know what? Maybe not. So.
Maybe not.
It's more like this. So your path to security maturity, like ours, may not be a straight line. There's going to be curves in the road. There's going to be pitfalls and setbacks, right? As we mentioned earlier, we did have the Dell EMC merger in 2016, where, you know, we had two large companies coming together, different cultures, different security governance bodies coming together. So we actually had to put a pause in our client-specific maturity path, right? And to realign and readjust with the merger and the changes coming with that merger, right? One of the key things that came out was that our central security office at that point, you know, centralized actually all the tools and services into that organization. And that kind of helped us scale by doing that. Also, you know, we continued to be use-specific, client-specific initiatives along the way, made sure they were aligned with what was going on PANDEL.
So another curve in our path was the dramatic increase in the number of vulnerabilities that impacted the entire industry. And then we had the Spectre meltdown vulnerabilities in early 2018.
Yeah,
and
January 3rd, 2018. I remember that day.
Yes, it's scarring.
Yes.
And then there was this continuous flow of side channel type vulnerabilities that followed.
And finally, another example is our underestimating our capacity, right? So, you know, had a lot of momentum, we were very eager, we got on the path, and you know, we did underestimate the resources required to get this and make it a success. So that was a key factor where we had to actually pause and realign and make sure we had it fully resourced, you know, to make this successful. So, like we said, your path to security maturity may not always be a straight line.
Yes, but you want to steer your organization so it doesn't turn into this. Oops. This.
Uh-oh. We lost the...
Or this.
Or this.
There you go.
So,
don't do this.
Yeah, don't do that. And that's actually why we're here, right? We're here, we've been through this, we want to share our key takeaways with you next.
Right, and so you can learn from our experiences. You know, we've been through this.
Right, and then, I don't think that was a Tesla.
Yeah, and I don't think that car has seatbelts.
Yeah, I don't think so, yeah.
So, yeah, we're going to actually be making reference to this driving off the cliff, you know.
Taking your plan down.
Yeah, yeah. Concept. We won't be showing this, but you'll hear this kind of
theme
repeat throughout the organization, or throughout the presentation. So, yeah, when we say, or you will drive over a cliff, if anyone in the audience wants to say cliff,
go for it.
Go for it. So, with that said, we would like to present our top 10 key takeaways. I wish someone had told me.
I wish someone had told me.
I guess we wish someone had told us.
Right, yeah, exactly. Would have been great. Yeah. So, we're going to start out going back to getting a measuring stick, right? So, to summarize this, you want to make sure you have one. That's a key point, right? Make sure you have a measuring stick, something that's aligned to the industry, something that works for your business. With that, set an achievable target on that. Again, make sure it's fully funded. Make sure it's fully resourced. You want to have that. And you're going to have to defend it. So, you know, you're going to have executives, you're going to have your managers and your teams asking you, why this framework? Why did you select it, right? Give me some data behind this framework. Why this target? Why are we trying to go to this target and not, you know, the highest target, right? So you're going to have to defend it. Make sure you come with data. Make sure you come to have that discussion.
Okay. So next is executive support. So the standards and policies that you'll need to drive throughout your organization need executive support. Executives help align priorities. Executive support gives you that top-down approach. And we talked about the bottom-up approach for our champions, and the executives are the top-down approach. The executive support is key to maintaining your direction, so especially with cross-functional team alignment. And you may face challenges when other priorities conflict. Or is it not changing?
It works.
So with your security maturity priorities, executive support can help with managing conflicting priorities within your business unit and across the organization, especially when you have cross-organizational alignment.
Right, exactly. And then there's the momentum we talked about. Like we said, you may have events, you may not have events, but if you do have an event or have some momentum, make sure you use that initial momentum to get this culture shift started, right? That's gonna really help you. The next factor that we think is key in momentum is maintaining that momentum, right? It's not good enough just to have some event and then you have this burst of energy and commitment from different folks. You need a way to keep that momentum going. And then finally, all that, especially a large company, a shipping ship like Dell, helps you turn that ship, right? To get over that inertia within the company.
Next on our top 10 is estimating capacity. So as part of your plan, you need to estimate the needed resources and your capacity for change. You'll want to be realistic. The key is to make sure you don't underestimate the amount of time and the resources you need when proposing the plan and getting commitments. So just like having too little momentum can be a problem, having too much momentum can be an issue. If you don't have especially if you don't have the capacity to drive it. This can cause some divergence in your plan with some of the teams. You might have some teams that continue with the initiatives on their own, but move in a different direction. Then it might take additional efforts to reestablish the alignment and get yourself back on your security maturity
right.
path.
That's actually a bend in the road, right? So it's one of those bends.
Yeah, and then, you know, don't go over the cliff, you know.
Right.
Or wear your seatbelt, right?
Like I said, drive a Tesla.
Or drive a Tesla.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. As part of estimating capacity, you want to take into consideration your time commitment. This takes a lot of time. It does not happen overnight. It's not going to happen over a couple of weeks and a couple of meetings. It takes time, and you want to make sure you have commitment for that time considered as part of your requirements. Like we said earlier, it may start small. And one of the key things with starting small that we learned along the way is that you need to have your transitions planned to full-time resources and make sure that you have that as part of your plan. That also means, like we mentioned earlier, you want to have those roles formalized. So when you are doing that transitions, it's clearly defined, for example, what you have as a champion, what is an advisor, and those roles are properly defined. Otherwise, it's going to show up as an issue, and you're going to have another setback along the way.
So next is funding. So funding for people. Consider the funding for your people requirements to support the plan and also to utilize that momentum. Make sure your people are formally allocated instead of using the ad hoc model. So at least just have a plan to transition. And hiring for security is hard, right? So you can consider maybe shifting people internally to security roles, especially if you found someone, you know, a volunteer that was interested in security and kind of filled that role. Then you can potentially hire somebody that's not in the security role and then use them to backfill. Also, make sure you consider funding to create your programs, such as your champion and advisor programs. Investment into process management and SDL activity tools, you should also consider that, such as your static code analysis and threat model, code review tools. And you know, don't forget about your infrastructure and your physical security requirements, you know, such as secure labs, controlled access, build servers, HSMs. You might even need to create a DevSecOps team, depending on the size of your organization. And then this may seem obvious, but don't overlook funding for training.
Right. And then speaking of training, the way we treat training is like real estate agents treat location, 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 right? Training, training, training is critical to get your culture shift going. We believe that's one of the key factors. And it should go without saying that it should be an ongoing activity and not a one-time event. So that's something we may have to reinforce with your teams and your executives. The other thing is that, and we touched on this, the Security Champion Program, make sure you have training dedicated for them, right? Make it a path. It could be the same as the, you know, the organization-wide training, but make sure you've considered that security champions need their own path and their own training associated with it. And then one of the tools that we touched on very early was that, hey, if you're looking for asking investments from your leadership on training, it's a tool that we can all use. It's better to invest in training now than it is to pay for a breach or a vulnerability later, right? It's a little hard-hitting, but you know, it gets the point across.
Cheaper than a breach.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a t-shirt.
Yeah, that's a t-shirt.
We should get some t-shirts.
Yeah. Yes. Next RSA.
We got budget for that? So next on our top 10 is adapt and adjust. So for your organization, you will most likely not have a straight line to security maturity. You know, sorry to break the news to you, but there are landscape changes, there are organizational changes, management, executive personnel changes that lead to shifts in priority. The key is not to get sidetracked by these changes, from small setbacks like minor changes in momentum or losses in momentum to larger events like, you know, being part of the largest tech merger ever.
It was pretty big. Yes, exactly.
So, you know, mergers happen, reorgs happen, priorities change. This all leads to your need to evaluate, adapt, and adjust. So stay agile and adapt to the bends in the road, or else.
Again, you know, you gotta watch out for that. With that, you know, we also wanna focus on the awareness. So, sorry, I clicked ahead. The awareness really helps build and maintain that momentum. We're touching on momentum a lot, and that's important because we mentioned earlier that we didn't consider that. But one thing that helps maintain that momentum is awareness programs. So make sure you have dedicated awareness initiatives throughout your organization. The other factor is keep it separate from your training. So when Richard and I and the team were going through our Security Champion program within client, at least within client organization, we kicked off a lot of kickoff meetings, we did a lot of training sessions, we did a lot of networking events, and that brought along with it a lot of awareness, right? But then we kind of sat back and said, okay, you guys got this, go off and do it, right? And we kind of sat back and we saw a dip in that momentum, right? And we actually had to go pretty much worldwide, site by site, doing awareness initiatives. And we just did that last year to regain that momentum, right? And that was something that we learned along the way, is that you want to make sure it's a separate effort and then you just can't roll it all into one. Yeah. That's pretty important.
We literally went around the world.
Yeah,
so all the Dell different sites. Regions.
Exactly. And then there's the factor that awareness and training both combined together is where we saw the culture shift actually take place, right? Having both separate yet combined initiatives really helps the organization start on that culture shift.
So next, establish community. So you may start out small with a group of borrowed resources like we talked about during the initial efforts. Your goal is to extend it and formalize it through training, awareness, maybe a champion program.
Yep.
Also, consider the resources and funding for this. Remember the awareness. Remember the awareness program sorry. You know, remember, awareness plus training leads to your culture shift. So utilizing the training and the awareness initiatives helps to foster that sense of community. And, you know, the champions are embedded in the teams. They work with their teammates on security initiatives. This helps foster the security mindset from the bottoms up. And so, you know, you might want to consider initiatives to help foster that sense of community. As an example, we have a community awareness initiative. It's been going on for nearly 8 years. It's called the Big Security Meeting.
We also call it the BS Meeting.
Yeah, BS Meeting.
Yeah.
This is a bi-weekly mini security conference. It covers security topics and news, and it's presented in an informal setting. The participation is open to all employees, and you don't need to be a security person to participate. It was founded by Rick Martinez. Rick Martinez is a senior distinguished engineer and a security strategist at Dell. Rick presented this talk in about security awareness initiatives at the Art into Science 2020 conference in Austin, Texas. He was and actually still is instrumental in our security maturity culture shift. And he's been fundamental in transforming the security maturity in our Dell client organization.
That's right. And so we gave you some of our insights and our lessons learned. Next, we'll talk about some calls to action and so how you can apply this to your organization. So, starting immediately, going back next week, what you can do is have that initial discussion with your leadership, right? Go in with some reports, some KPIs, some metrics. You can take our presentation if you think it's worth it, but just have that conversation started, right? That's the short-term goal.
Right, and then gauge your organization's appetite for security. Was there an event, you know, and find your measuring stick, and then, you know,
yeah.
Try not to create your own negative event.
Right, exactly.
To get things going.
It's not the way to start.
Nope.
And then in the next 3 months to come, you want to have this group of ad hoc volunteers, especially if you want to start out small, you don't have a central security office or whatever the case may be in your organization, but get the teams that are aligned with what your goals are and get yourself in a governance body to start that culture shift.
And then do an initial gap assessment of your security program using your measuring stick. If you have funding, this may be done with an external audit, for example.
And then 6 to 12 months from then, you want to go to your leadership and recommend some targets, right? You may have a baseline by now. You have a framework that you've chosen, some maturity. And then have a couple targets and recommendations so your leadership can understand where you're trying to get to.
Right. And then you know, identify gaps and develop a plan to address them. So there's champion program requirements and the distribution of your champions in your organization that are needed to help scale your SDL activities and requirements. Consider the number of advisors that you need to support your SDL governance and also support, you know, your champion program. And then consider the funding needed to help drive it all.
Right. And then
finally.
Yeah.
Mohit.
Richard.
You got to sell it.
Right.
Right. You got to sell it to your team members. You got to sell it to your champions.
Yep.
Got to sell it to your advisors and leadership.
And don't forget, you got to drive it.
Beyond engineering. Don't forget, beyond engineering.
Yeah, exactly. like we were saying, you got to drive it. We mentioned drive it through your awareness programs, your training programs, your education programs. The key point there is that you're trying to make sure it stays on people's minds and it stays front and center, right?
That's right. And you need to constantly assess it.
Yep.
Right. You need to make sure that you're moving in the right direction.
Right. And as we've been mentioning, you're going to have those curves in the road. And if you do face those curves, you adjust with those curves, right?
Right. Otherwise, you will
again
drive over a cliff.
Cliff, exactly. Like that joke.
Right, like that joke. All right. So that is our presentation.
Yep.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very
much. And dude, you got a Dell.
Dude, you got a Dell. Thank you very much, guys.
Any questions?
Yeah, a question. Corporate governance can be a messy matter, and I'm wondering where sometimes because of mergers or sometimes just because a corporation decides to organize itself as you know, quasi-autonomous units, is it better to have a single security organization try to manage it all or independent ones for the independent organizations? Or if you acquire somebody and they have their own thing and they're somewhat down the path, how do you merge them together?
It's actually a really good question. So, and it's a great, you know, example of what we experienced. So You know, we talked about the Dell EMC merger. We talked about how we had to align with the Pan-Dell organization. Mohit and I, and then you know, our colleague Rick and other advisors that we had in the client organization, we were going down our security initiative. Then the Pan-Dell organization came in, and they had their Pan-Dell requirements. So I think the answer to your question is it's a hybrid approach.
Yep.
So you have a high-level organization that sets your policies across the company, and then you have your business units that will be based on those standards, but then also have their own specific SDL governance that is applicable to their products and their business unit.
Yeah, I think the hybrid solution is the best approach. That's what's been working for us, and I think it's been a success so far.
And so, points to you for asking one of the best questions that we can set an example to.
Yeah, exactly.
Any other questions? All right, well, thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it, and it was a very awesome experience.
Yeah, thank you very much, everyone.
Hope you enjoy the rest of your conference.
Yep.
Thank you.